Okay, one more before I leave this car park and go back to pick up my daughter as I need to. So, Mark chapter 12. This is where Jesus is really right in the thick of it. You know, he's getting antagonized from every side, and he's having to kind of argue with the different groups of authorities in Jerusalem. So, chapter 12, verse 13, they sent to him some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him. Herodians were into the connection with Rome and the political gain that they could get from that. And the Pharisees, of course, were law-abiding, law-obsessed Jewish elite. And so you've got kind of a strange combination. Essentially, it feels like whatever you say to satisfy a Herodian is going to get you in trouble with a Pharisee, and whatever you say to satisfy a Pharisee is going to get you in trouble with a Herodian. These are not, you know, a natural tag team pairing, but they're sent to trap Jesus. And so they come to him and they say, paying taxes to Caesar, should we or shouldn't we? And so Jesus knows their hypocrisy, and he says, give me a denarius, let me look at it. And they brought one. And he looked at it, he said, okay, whose likeness and inscription is this? They said to him, Caesar's. And then Jesus comes out with this classic line, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. Now, I wonder if that's familiar, it's familiar language, and the danger with familiar passages is that we go, oh, that's right, yeah, render to Caesar. Right, render to Caesar. What do we render to Caesar? Tax. That's kind of the point there, right? And I suppose obedience to the law, that's kind of it, right? You know, be a good citizen. But render to God what is God's. What does that actually involve? It seems to me that maybe we so often hear the render to Caesar as a sort of tax reference or as a throwaway line of something or other, that we forget the actual punchline, which is render to God that which is God's, the things that are His. Be good to start making a list, wouldn't it? Render to the government that which belongs to the government. Pay your taxes. Yeah, that's a given. Now, what does it mean to render to God that which is God's? Does it involve our money? Does it involve our time? Does it involve our energy? Does it involve our affection? Does it involve our behavior, our attitudes? Does it influence how we spend our Sundays, how we spend our weekends, how we spend our weekdays? That actually it affects everything, doesn't it? Render to God that which is God's. And it's a contrast too, because we want to. That's the beauty of it. It's not like this religious burden. When it's a religious burden, we tend to ask, okay, what's the least I can get away with? But when it's a captivated heart, which is what Jesus came to do, really, to really grab a hold of our hearts. Well, then it's more a question of, okay, what can I give him? What can I give him? Not what do I have to, but what can I give to him? Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. Maybe take a piece of paper, make a list of every element of your life, every possession, every skill, everything, and then give it to God. Right? Because there's nothing on that list that isn't his. There's nothing there that we can say, yeah, but that's mine. Now render to God the things that are God's. I suppose we could say, what? That seems a bit demanding. That seems a bit overbearing. Like, how can we do that? But then we remember the context of this conversation, that this was the week before Jesus went to the cross and gave everything for us. And in light of that, in light of him giving everything for us, actually, it brings us back to, yeah, I want to give everything for him.